whether AC or DC, we are educated to believe that we require two polarities to affect matter, electrically or magnetically, to complete the circuit for an electrical load to work, such as the plus or minus from a battery, or in the case of alternating currents, the active and neutral opposite polarities. In any case, the belief of this requirement of opposite polarities may have been somewhat encouraged by Maxwell's equations published from between 1861 and 1862, the mathematical distillation of decades of prior electrical observations of electric and magnetic effects of charges and currents achieved with very primitive equipment. The final, say, the be-all, end-all of all electrical theory, to quote Oliver Heaviside, does Maxwell spell finality? There is no finality. From 1885 to 1887, Oliver Heaviside published Electromagnetic Theory, and in the preface he also stated, whether Maxwell's theory will last as a sufficient and satisfactory primary theory upon which the numerous secondary developments required may be grafted, is a matter for the future to determine. Let it not be forgotten that Maxwell's theory is only the first step towards a full theory of the ether, and moreover, that no theory of the ether can be complete that does not fully account for the omnipresent force of gravitation. Oliver Heaviside reformulated Maxwell's field equations in terms of electric and magnetic forces and energy flux. Maxwell's formulation of electromagnetism originally consisted of 20 equations and 20 variables. Heaviside employed the curl and divergence operators of the vector calculus to reformulate 12 of these 20 equations into 4 equations in 4 variables, B, E, J, and rho, the form of which they have been known ever since. Maxwell's own contribution to his original equations is a correction to Ampere's circuit law shown as the last term of the first equation. The others were borrowed from other existing laws which were based on observed phenomena such as positive and negative charges are somewhat equivalent to a magnet's respective north and south poles that always must be present to have a magnet. Similarly, an equivalent positive and negative charge, which are equal and opposite, you can never have one without the other. In particular, Maxwell's second law, or Gauss's law for magnetism, show that the magnetic fields cancel out due to perfect opposite symmetry, 2 equals 0, showing that the total flux going out into free space is cancelled out by the total flux coming in. In between this flow, we get a magnet to stick to a fridge or electrical currents to do some work, which in the case of currents requires constant power to be delivered into the system. Therefore, by convention, currents should only travel from plus high potential to minus low potential. This was deduced long before scientists even discovered the electron. In practice today, we believe that current in metal conductors consists of unbound negative electrons moving from negative to positive. In a p-type semiconductor, it consists of positive holes traveling from positive to negative. In an ionic liquid, it may consist of negative or positive charge ions traveling one way or the other. Inside a battery, it's the other way around. Positive charge travels from the negative electrode to the positive one, then completes a circuit by traveling from the positive one through the load back to the negative one. Therefore, theoretically, and based on current understanding, we should only be able to illuminate an incandescent light source in the following ways. 1. The most common method in use today, based on common education, is to use the plus and minus terminals from a battery. Current physics asserts that the movement of electrons flowing through a wire is from a surplus negative point towards a lesser negative or deficient point that we call the positive. The charge travels through the load back to the negative electrode, or in the case of alternating currents, the active and neutral opposite polarities. Electrical conductivity is analogous to transparency of certain materials to light. Materials that easily conduct light are called transparent, while those that don't are called opaque. As for alternating currents, the principle is based on current flow that swings from positive to negative at a rate called the frequency, that in the case of Australian mains current is 50 times a second, or 50 Hertz. Our frequency formula tells us that if we divide the frequency over speed of light constant, we obtain a wavelength of 6 million meters, which is the length of a full wave swing from negative to positive, so is somewhat in tune with long lengths of wire, and hence the reason why we transmit in this way. So if this line represented a distance of 6 million meters, one full wave will span the length and alternate between positive and negative 50 times a second. Therefore, T equals 1 on F. This wave pushes forward, creating a continuous current, so it behaves very much like our DC current, in that each time one side of the generator produces a wave that is positive, the other side of the generator will be negative. Lesser known methods based on present day radio design philosophy that forms the basis for most antenna design also allows the following electromagnetic wave connections to be made in free space, allowing us to illuminate light sources a few more ways that may follow using. 2. A dipole antenna, which is the basis of most antenna designs, which is a balanced component with equal but opposite voltages and currents applied at its two terminals, which are two quarter wave dipoles, or a half of a wavelength coil with a light source tapped in the center, showing free space transmission. To demonstrate this, I attach to a 6.3 volt 0.25 amp rated MES incandescent indicator light source two links of wire. The incandescent light source will illuminate, indicating when electrons flow. When we hold the light source and a switch on the transmitter, we get a faint glow, but when we tune it precisely by shortening the wires slightly in this case, the light source begins to illuminate to a higher degree as we tune it in. The waves come out of the transmitting antenna and pass through the receiver aerial wires. The electrons in the wire experience the waves and are pushed up towards one end of the wire and back down again towards the other. The electrons resist and try to bounce back like a spring. If the electrons are bouncing and the waves pushing are in time, which we call in tune with each other, then it works. But what happens if the timing is wrong? What happens if the antenna is too long or too short? Then it doesn't work. The transmitter's maximum output is 25 watts and allows me to even power 240 volt mains power light sources wirelessly from 15 to 40 watts. Here is a 240 volt 15 watt BC incandescent GLS light source with a dipole attached. For the next experiments, no antenna is necessary as the light source's filaments are long enough. Here is a 240 volt 30 watt tungsten incandescent strip light, and here another far more antique 40 watt strip light with a mirror reflector. These have to be placed close to the aerial to operate as they are not directly in tune with the transmitted electromagnetic waves. Another interesting phenomenon that I can demonstrate is that by taking another tuned antenna and placing it in front, the one in the back goes out. Take it away and it lights up again. Now this is something we see visible light doing all the time. Visible light casts shadows everywhere, and even though antennas that are too short or too long don't stop or absorb the waves to any degree, they can still affect them. antennas that are too short can bend or concentrate the electromagnetic waves, or if they are longer, they can reflect them. Now, if this was visible light that we were dealing with, we would call the long ones mirrors and the short ones lenses. We can also use a Schottky diode to rectify to direct current to power a DC pager motor. As can be seen, there is no battery, just some SMD, Schottky diode and a dipole, and yet another wirelessly powered controlled flight seems achievable. As you can see, it is in its simplest form. Yes, just an antenna and a Schottky diode is powering the motor. I can then add a reflector or director to increase the antenna's directivity and gain by directing them in a beam in one direction. So I now obtain a small remote control helicopter, and using standard radio propagation theory and formulas, I design what is basically a Yagi-Uda antenna array, which modifies the radiation pattern of the radio waves emitted by the driven element, increasing the antenna's gain. I have removed and replaced the onboard battery with this Yagi antenna. The dipole-driven pair has a SMD Schottky diode between them, just as in the previous demonstration. I also add a SMD voltage regulator and small inductors and capacitors to tune the received energy to be compatible with this helicopter's original battery-operated control circuitry. Now, after some experimental fine-tuning and patience, and hopefully some good flight control, we switch on the power and can see that the power is received by the onboard red LED. So, ready for takeoff. And to quote Yuri Gagarin, "Poyekhli!" Now, when I add to the battery or alternating power generator from the previous drawing, an electronic circuit that transforms the electric power into radio frequency alternating currents, which reverses their direction millions to billions of times per second, depending on the particular frequency it is designed to transmit, via a wave transmission aerial. Then the energy from the antenna generates rapidly reversing current that radiate off a conductor, such as our antenna, as electromagnetic waves, also known as radio waves. This is described by Maxwell's Faraday equation, also known as Faraday's law of induction, and the four Maxwell's equations along with the Lorentz force law, which are today believed to be sufficiently adequate to derive everything known in classical electromagnetism. In the same way, as per the previous demonstration, the electromagnetic waves travel through space, the two quarter wave antennas receive the energy at the two equal and opposite quarter wave peaks. The potential difference between the two opposing polarities from both antenna hearts can power a load, whether a motor or light source. From the equal and opposite potential created within the aerial from the received electromagnetic waves. 3. A self-resonant full-wave loop antenna, which can be considered to be a folded dipole reformed into a circle or square, etc. This loop has a circumference approximately equal to one wavelength and will also be resonant at odd multiples of a wavelength. The loop can also be reformed into other shapes, such as coils, stars, or other configurations to reduce the surface area. Yes, this system also works. It may seem non-intuitive for the loop antenna appears to be a short circuit, but due to the high frequencies employed as well as the fact that the length of wire is tuned to a full wavelength, it therefore operates by the same principles electrically as per the previous demonstrations, in that there is a potential difference between two opposing polarities. The tuned antenna peaks at a quarter wave. The loop is actually a folded dipole which causes the light source to illuminate from an equal and opposite potential difference, just like before. 4. An antenna coil in the form of a quarter wave monopole antenna, which could be considered as half of a dipole using your ground plane as the image of the other half. In other words, the other end is earthed. Reduction of the length of the aerial could be achieved by coiling the antenna, which becomes an inductor or loading coil in series with the antenna tuned to be resonant. Yes, works as well. This demonstration relies on one dipole. The ground acts as the other half of the dipole and could be due to ground conductivity, also referred to as ground wave transmission. Radio transmissions in the low to medium frequency bands ranging from 30 to 3000 kHz are particularly reliant on good ground conductivity, as their primary propagation is by surface waves. Once again, this configuration operates by the same principles electrically as per the previous demonstrations, in that there is a potential difference between two opposing polarities. In this case, the antenna and ground, the tuned antenna peaks at a quarter wave, which once again causes the light source to illuminate from an equal and opposite potential difference. The main purpose of the experiment shown was to quickly demonstrate the outcome of electromagnetic theory from antenna calculations in terms of Maxwell's equations. Now, all the above demonstrations are based on Maxwell's predicted symmetry, which is a balanced component with equal but opposite voltages and currents applied at the light source's two input terminals via various antenna configurations, where the electrons in the wire experience the waves and are pushed up towards one end of the wire and back down again towards the other. The electrons resisting bounce back like a spring, and as long as the electrons bouncing and the waves pushing are in time, then the light sources or motors will function. And now wait for the drum roll. 5. A monopole antenna showing an unbalanced component with equal but opposite voltages and currents present, but is only applied to one terminal, which is a quarter wavelength monopole aerial with a light source tapped at the end, showing a free space transmission with the opposing end connected to what I believe Eric Dollard refers to as a counter-spatial connection from counter space, and what Tom Bearden refers to as enabling the flow of energy to commence from its source, the vacuum of space-time. Let's try another experiment. If we connect an aerial and slide the incandescent light source up and down, we should see the peaks of the wave trough that illuminate the light source at various positions of length on the antenna. You can clearly see the peaks corresponding to the quarter wave peaks or harmonics of the incoming and reflected waves. This is also clearly shown with a 240 volt 30 watt and as well as a 240 volt 40 watt strip lamp experiment we performed previously. In either case, no other connection or additional errors were necessary. It is also clear that the electricity travels as a field around the wire as opposed to through the wire as commonly taught. It is at these peaks that the filament is heated the most. Does this explain the results shown? For if electricity travels through a good conductor, such as a wire, as is currently taught, the electricity should be present at every point. How else could we explain these results? Astute observers or experiments in the field watching may suspect that the capacity at the lamp's base is providing the return path from the antenna to ground, such as when a typical Tesla coil that generates high voltages that transmit electrical energy directly into the atmosphere, thereby anchoring the power directly into the air and the earth to go through the air to get back to the ground, lighting a low pressure light source in between. If this is the case, then we would achieve an increased brightness if I was to earth the base with my hand. No, goes duller. But wait, I may be acting as an untuned antenna and detuning the area when I bring my hand close, so I will actually earth it with an earth connection and it also decreases in brightness. Now, I earth both ends and it still remains illuminated. By the way, interestingly, it is actually brighter without the other dipole when placed at the same distance. It was of course Tesla who discovered, or at least reported, that when dealing with alternating currents of high frequency, there was another condition and came up with a monopolar method where a circuit only required one pole and that there was no requirement to connect the circuit to anything else. No return circuit or pathway was necessary. To quote Tesla from the Inventions, Research and Writings of Nikola Tesla published in the year 1893, however impractical this plan of working may appear in many cases, it certainly seems practical and even recommendable in the production of light. A perfected lamp would require but little energy, and if wires were used at all, we ought to be able to supply that energy without a return wire. It is now a fact that a body may be rendered incandescent or phosphorescent by bringing it either in single contact or merely in the vicinity of a source of electric impulses of the proper character, and that in this manner a quantity of light sufficient to afford a practical illuminant may be produced. It is therefore, to say the least, worthwhile to attempt to determine the best conditions and to invent the best appliances for obtaining this object. Is my demonstration the fulfillment of Tesla's prediction, i.e. the worthwhile invention for attaining this object? The transmitter used in this experiment is of low power and the output voltage is also low, so therefore does not readily illuminate low pressure light sources such as fluorescent and neon lamps. By comparison, the Tesla coil is connected to the ground and the other end of the coil generates very high voltages that transmit electrical energy directly into the atmosphere, thereby anchoring the power directly into the air and the earth. The electrical energy leaves the Tesla coil to go through the air to get back to the ground. If a fluorescent light source is held near the coil, the transmitted electrical energy will then go through the low pressure light source to get back to the ground, which makes it light up, or via a direct connection to the output terminal, connect an incandescent light source through my body that goes back to the earth, completing the circuit. This demonstrates the difference. So to illuminate low pressure lamps with a low energy transmitter used in the previous experiments, we have to ionize the pathway with a spark, and voila, it also now illuminates low pressure lamps such as neon indicator lamps, a neon spherical. Note, the color is now violet instead of the traditional orange as the gas is excited to a far higher energy level or electron orbit. Even fluorescent lamps of various configurations illuminate in free space when held close to the transmission aerial, once ionized with a higher voltage, just like the starter that creates a high voltage spike to start fluorescent lamps. So there we have it. I have demonstrated wireless or electricity, electromagnetic powered free flight using accepted modern day radio propagation theory that achieves a highly directional line of sight reception of energy as opposed to using Tesla's technology. refer anti-gravity method 15B, part B of 15, world's first free flight of a Tesla coil powered flying saucer. Please note the difference in the electromagnetic technology design philosophy. So, what's the point of all these toys that I demonstrate? Well, it is said that when Benjamin Franklin observed the first balloon ascension in 1783, while he was ambassador at the court of France, someone asks, "What possible use are balloons?" Franklin answers, "What use is a newborn baby?" Likewise, Michael Faraday, who invented the first electrical motor in 1821, was visited by a delegation of government dignitaries. They are shown his electric motors and other demonstrations. One person says, "This is all very interesting, but of what possible use are these toys?" Faraday responds, "I cannot say what use they may be, but I can confidently predict that one day you'll be able to tax them." These toys demonstrate that we can replace our batteries, our mess of electrical cables dangling everywhere, our battery chargers, and even our petrol motors with tuned antennas or coils which could be supplied with electrical energy delivered wirelessly through space, even harvested from ambient radiation that is everywhere. To quote Tesla, "Throughout space there is energy. Is this energy static or kinetic? If static, our hopes are in vain. If kinetic, and this we know it is for certain, then it is a mere question of time when men will succeed in attaching the machinery to the very wheelwork of nature." Some will argue that electromagnetic theory is one of the chief intellectual achievements of the human species over the last two centuries. Others believe that the understanding of electromagnetism embodied in Maxwell's equations is relativistically invariant and can only be correct when interpreted in the light of Einstein's theory of special relativity. To quote Tesla, "Einstein's relativity work is a magnificent mathematical garb which fascinates, dazzles, and makes people blind to the underlying errors. The theory is like a beggar clothed in purple, whom ignorant people take for a king. Its exponents are brilliant men, but they are metaphysicists rather than scientists. And the scientists from Franklin to Morse were clear thinkers and did not produce erroneous theories. The scientists of today think deeply instead of clearly. One must be sane to think clearly, but one can think deeply and be quite insane." These appear to be harsh words, but have to be put into context, for it was during Tesla's time that science was then based on solid fundamental empirical foundations, used experimental tools to test theories and prove phenomena that led to gigantic leaps and bounds of advancement, which began to sway when a new theoretical physics began to emerge, a philosophy that could never be tested or confirmed scientifically. Where experiments could not be done, so theoretical physics continues to advance through the use of mathematical models. Even though there hasn't been a major success in theoretical physics for at least 30 years, some would argue at least 100. Our history shows that the major advancement of science depended in general on the interplay between theory and experimental work. Edwin Armstrong, the creator of FM radio, summed it up nicely when he stated, "Men substitute words for reality, and then argue about the words." Today, scientists say that 1 cubic centimeter of vacuous space has enough residual energy in it to produce 100 million suns when you cool it down to absolute zero, called zero point energy, and that there's more energy in 1 cubic meter of space due to the Higgs field that the sun outputs in 1,000 years. We are therefore like birds sitting on electrical power lines, wondering where all the energy is. By analogy, if we all lived at the bottom of the ocean of energy, all I have done is stuck the aerial to a point where the energy of the waves begin to hit it. I highly recommend Eric Dollard's work, truly one of the greatest minds of our current time. So stay tuned. This and hopefully much more to come, but only if enough interest is generated, and with the aid of your donations, even far more exciting experiments. For I know you're out there. I can only show you a path through my experiments. Do your own research, and more importantly, do your own experiments. Be objective. Do use the scientific method vigorously. You have to make up your own mind and free it from the confines of the technological matrix that is a prison for our minds and holds us back from an amazing and fantastic future.